The Haile Selassie First Period, Part 1, Rastafari's Regency and Emperorship, 1916-1936. Yasu stayed at large among Muslim sympathizers in the districts of Afar for about 5 years, but was ultimately captured and put in jail. In the meantime, Fitaurari Habt-e-Gheorghis, a trusted official of Menelik who supported Rastafari in his bid for the regency, wielded power behind the scenes. But his death in 1926 allowed Efari to practice what his title denoted, crown prince and regent with unlimited political powers. In 1928, Rastafari was crowned Negus, and at the empress's death in 1930, he was crowned emperor as Lion of the Tribe of Judah, Elect of God, and King of Kings of Ethiopia. In the years prior to the Italian-Ethiopian War of 1935-1936, Haile Selassie I became a champion of modernization, generally known in Ethiopia as Me'erabawi Seletane, Western civilization. In 1920, he commissioned a group of legal pundits to develop modern bureaucratic procedures and legal rules by consulting codes from Western Europe. Teferi was a reformer par excellence. He abandoned reliance on a peasant fighting force and created instead a modern army trained first by the White Russians, who were loyal to the overthrown Romanov family and were opposed to and fought against the Bolsheviks led by Lenin in the early 1900s, and then later by the Belgians. He promulgated the country's first constitution, and in July 1931, he established a bicameral parliament. While carrying out his administrative reform, Haile Selassie I was careful to reserve for himself absolute power, suggesting that the political power emanated from divine will. One of the clauses of the Constitution, Article 11, stated, "The person of the emperor is sacred, his dignity inviolable, and his power indisputable." Other clauses reserved for the emperor exclusive prerogative over central and local government, the legislature, the judiciary, and the executive, as well as the military establishment. Starting in 1930, Rastafari secured the cooperation of various international banking institutions and established the Bank of Ethiopia, which starting in 1931 is issued an Ethiopian currency. He introduced the first airplane into the country. More were added later, until Ethiopia was being served by a dozen airplanes just before the Italian invasion in 1936. To enhance the dissemination of information and general knowledge, Teferi founded the Berhanena Selam Printing Press and established the first radio station in the country. He expanded Western education and established the first secondary school in the country. He also sent hundreds of young Ethiopians to study abroad. By befriending the West, which was set to fight against both fascism and communism, Haile Selassie I quickly secured reliable allies abroad. To join the family of modern nations, Rastafari abolished slavery, and by that act succeeded in getting Ethiopia accepted into the League of Nations. Additionally, because of great pressure from the European powers that had colonized the rest of the continent, Rastafari signed the Arms Trafficked Act with Britain, France, and Italy. But the regent did not sign the agreement until he had secured legal guarantees that the Ethiopian state could procure arms to guard against external aggression and to maintain internal order. In 1925, Teferi invoked Ethiopia's membership in the League and frustrated a British-Italian agreement to encroach on Ethiopian sovereignty. Without consulting Addis Ababa, the nations had agreed that Italy would build a railway through Ethiopia connecting its colonies of Eritrea and Somalia, and that Britain would build a dam on Lake Tana. Teferi expanded the number of roads, schools, and hospitals in the country and sent hundreds of Ethiopian youth to study abroad and then returned back to serve in the modern bureaucracy he created. Teferi also weakened the position of the traditional nobility. The only thing he did not do, which was to become his undoing later during his imperial reign, was try to address the intricate problem of land tenure, which was linked to traditional political order, the royal family, the feudal nobility, and the church. fascist invasion, and the Ethiopian resistance. Barely 5 years after Haile Selassie I was crowned, Mussolini, who wanted to avenge the Italian defeat at Adwa and to revive the Roman Empire, launched in October 1935 an invasion force of 500,000 men, well-trained and armed with hundreds of tanks and fighter planes, against an Ethiopian feudal army equipped only with old guns, spears, and clubs. Despite the odds against them, the Ethiopian fighters put up a stiff resistance for 6 months, and Mussolini's troops succeeded in entering Addis Ababa only after brutally spraying poison gas, which was prohibited by the Geneva Convention, on soldiers and civilians alike. Haile Selassie I went into exile in England after making a final and futile plea to the League of Nations at Geneva. Ethiopian freedom fighters, however, did not give up. They continued their struggle by reverting to guerrilla warfare. As soon as the last conventional defense was broken, the Western educated youth, most of whom had initially been conscripted into the imperial bodyguard, regrouped themselves into guerrilla units and founded a political party, the first of its kind in Ethiopian history, known as the Tekur Anbesa, Black Lion. Other Western educated Ethiopians, in collaboration with their traditionally educated cohorts, later formed the Committee of the Union and Collaboration Against Italian Fascism and disseminated information and propaganda against the occupying force. Tadasse Macha, 1951-71. The Italians continued their merciless bombings and poison gas attacks against villages occupied by members of the resistance. Mussolini, in the meantime, had poured into Ethiopia about 250,000 Italian settlers, believing that the country was peaceful enough for systematic colonization by whites. However, patriotic resistance continued. The fascist attempt to disarm the people helped the cause of the liberation struggle, for Ethiopians would rather sacrifice their lives than lose their guns. Hundreds of thousands thus joined the ranks of the patriotic fighters, and Mussolini soon found that his white settlers, or colonists, had to be protected by an army almost twice their number. After Italian black shirts slaughtered tens of thousands of Ethiopian civilians in the city of Addis Ababa and monastery of Libanos, the Ethiopian guerrillas, bolstered by enthusiastic new recruits, moved to within 24 miles of Addis Ababa and harassed the Italians who ventured outside the fortified central city limits. The Patriots avoided engaging the fascist army whenever they had superior forces. They attacked only when they felt that their numbers as well as their arms were equal to or better than their enemies. They raided military convoys. As times passed, the Patriots expanded the theater of war to such an extent that the Italians could supply the outpost outside Addis Ababa only by air. According to eyewitness reports from a correspondent from the Luxembourg newspaper Escher Tageblatt, during the final months of 1937, the Italians were in control of only the major cities and towns. The correspondent adds that it was impossible to travel on any motor roads in Ethiopia without being escorted by armed convoys. This military situation was confirmed by a reporter from the London Times. At the end of 1937, battalion-level fascist military units had met a series of defeats at the hands of the Ethiopian forces, which were armed with weapons captured in previous engagements. In Gojam and Begemder, in particular, there was no Italian presence except at a few isolated fortified spots, where they were virtually surrounded and received food and ammunition by aircraft. According to a British reporter, at the beginning of 1938, wounded and sick Italian soldiers arriving in, Port said, revealed that bands of Ethiopian warriors are constantly attacking military outposts throughout the country and inflicting mass destruction. The Evening Standard, February 4, 1938, page 1-2. Correspondents for major British newspapers also reported that in mid-1938, trainloads of wounded Italian soldiers were constantly shipped through Djibouti. The Italians themselves have started to recognize the success of the Ethiopian guerrillas' new tactics. They clearly recognized the expertise of Ethiopian fighters in the art of surprise and attack, and the Italians were far from controlling areas outside the urban centers. According to one high fascist official in Ethiopia, Rafael De Lauro, in many areas as close as the suburbs of Addis Ababa, the Italians could not restore public order. De Lauro, 1949, 126, 303. During the final years of the occupation, power was slipping out of the hands of the fascists, who were surrounded by Ethiopian guerrillas. Garasu Duki's 12,000 guerrilla force, well armed with war materials captured from the fascists, had surrounded the city of Jimma and put it under siege. As the Italian officer on the spot wrote, the city was in peril. The Italian soldiers and civilians rarely slept at night. Perioti, 1940-1941. In the suburbs of Addis Ababa, where Abebe Aregai's force of 30,000 constantly harassed the invaders, 35 main forts connected with a network of barbed wire were constructed. Even hotels where the Italians stayed, such as the Albergo Imperial, were fenced in with barbed wire. Consul General Bonaccorsi, commander of the fascist black shirts in East Africa, thus reported to Rome. If at any point a detachment of English or Frenchmen were to enter with a banner unfurled, they would need little or no troops, for they would find the vast mass of the Abyssinian population would unite themselves and eject our forces. Steer, 1942, 41, 42. It was only July 12, 1940, when Mussolini declared war on the Allies by approving the invasion of France by the German Nazis, that the UK government officially declared it would support the anti-Italian fascist struggle in Ethiopia. Thus, Emperor Haile Selassie I, who was in exile in Britain, was flown from his exile residence in Bath, England, to Khartoum, Sudan. Ethiopians in exile in the Sudan and Kenya were subsequently provided with military training under General Orde Wingate and were equipped with 10,000 Springfield rifles and Bren guns. Whenever they had fortified themselves and whenever they moved on the roads, the Italian armies were ceaselessly harassed by the growing patriotic force, now bolstered by British support. On April 13, 1941, a fascist cavalry regiment of 450 troops was moving from Addis Ababa to Addis Alem when they were ambushed by the patriots. Only 50 got away with their lives. Birkbeck, 1942, 239, 240. In Gojam, the strong Italian fortification at Buer was besieged by the patriots, and several attempts to break out were repulsed. The morale of the Italian colonial troops soon plummeted, and mass desertion ensued. In the North Central Front, the Italians reported that a ferocious war had broken out at Debarque Gondar, and 400 Italian troops were killed by the patriots. Sakota was under the control of patriot forces led by Wagshum Wilson Hailu, and the Italians had failed to recapture it during the previous 5 years. Gayant and Este were taken by Johannes Yasu, son of the deposed Emperor Lij Yasu. Patriots had likewise captured Debre Zait, Magdala, Debre Tabor, and Azeso. Gondar, one of the most important historical cities, was also captured by the patriots, who crept up astonishing precipices unexpectedly by night and cut the road leading to Wolkite. Government of the United Kingdom, 40-60, 140-141. Rasiyum Mengesha of Tigray raised an army of 20,000 men, and together with Wagshum Wosin Hailu, attacked the Italian army that was entrenched at Amba Alagi, and then attacked General Frushi's headquarters near Mechu. According to Birkbeck, who was an eyewitness to this engagement, the victory was achieved through the hand-to-hand fighting, and every bomb the patriots threw was stamped "Made in Italy." Captured from the enemy, the patriots fought with open-eyed bravery, and they suffered fairly heavy casualties. Birkbeck, 1950-290. Guerrilla bands supported by the local inhabitants, armed only with obsolete guns and spears, also captured Goram. De Lauro attributes Italian defeat at Combalcha to the patriotic forces that scaled the precipices like squirrels and attacked the Italians day and night. The Battle of Combalcha, he adds, was the battle of bandits and was won by them. De Lauro, 1949, 259, 260. Degesmach, Nagash's Gojam guerrillas also engaged the Italian army moving from their Bur and Debre Marcos forts and defeated them. At Mota, Andergat Chu, Masai, and Wagchum Wosun Hailu attacked and captured the Italians in their forts. Dangila and Injebara also fell to Ethiopian guerrillas after heavy fighting. In the south, Ras Mesfin Seleshi's fighting force had defeated the Italian army commanded by General Gazara at Buno Bedele. Fetaurari Olana's patriotic fighters captured the Italian military garrison at Yubdo, Weyega, with valuable stocks of arms and ammunition. In confiscated, hoarded Maria Teresa dollars, the Austrian minted currency of particular importance was the value of the thaler, which is made of pure silver and was used and coveted in the entire Middle East and Horn of Africa because of its value. They also neutralized and captured 26 Italian black shirt battalions. Steer, 1942, 162. If these forces had not been put out of action, they could have been used against the British in Keren, Eritrea, where the last major encounter between the Commonwealth forces and the Italians occurred. It was in the wake of these events that South African, Southern Rhodesian, and Belgian forces arrived and found the enemy in retreat wherever military engagements between the British and the Italians were made. The Patriots were used as a support force, either for initial attack or in mopping up operations. According to Di Lauro, when the South African army went to attack the Italian army near Ankober, they successfully employed 6,000 Ethiopian guerrillas carrying 20 portable cannons at the front. At Combalcha, the Patriots, who were assigned to fight on the flanks by the South African army, occupied to every important mountain heights and rushed in fearlessly and mercilessly at the climax of the battle, following which the broken Italian soldiers fled. Government of the United Kingdom, 116-117. The stamina of the weary Ethiopian mountain warriors astonished the South Africans. Birkbeier commented, for example, the Ethiopian fighters had legs and arms like matchsticks, but they could run with a 27 kg case of mortar bombs where he could barely stagger. Birkbeier, 1950-237. As for the fascist soldiers, they tried to avoid capture by the Patriots, fearing retaliation for the atrocities they had committed, and felt relieved when the British forces appeared on the scene. According to J.F. MacDonald, 1957, the Italian soldiers near Lake Abaya and Shashimani were too glad to surrender to the British. For weeks they had trudged over rain-swept, inhospitable hillsides, constantly harried by Shifta guerrillas, who gave them no rest at night and hung on their flanks all day, 207-208. As a matter of fact, the British strategy for demoralizing the Italian soldiers was to threaten to let loose the Ethiopian patriots on their fortifications. At Dera, when 14,000 Italian troops stubbornly continued to fight against Gedeon force and Ethiopian patriots, Wingate ordered a lull on the attack and then threatened to let the Patriots storm into the fort and capture the black shirts. The Italians immediately surrendered when they were informed of the threat. There can be no doubt that even without British intervention, the patriotic forces that already numbered about 500,000 by 1940, despite their initial lack of coordination, could have ultimately liberated Ethiopia from the fascists. But the Disintegration of the Italian army within a span of a few months was achieved partly through British and Commonwealth engagements at major Italian army concentrations at Amba, Alaghe, Debremarcos, Tembidoyo, Mega, and Keren, where aircraft, artillery, and tanks not available to the Ethiopian guerrillas were effectively employed. A number of the British officers and civilians who participated in or watched the war at close quarters fully agree on one point. The patriotic struggle was crucial in bringing about a speedy fascist defeat. But when one British author went to the extent of suggesting that it was the Ethiopians and not the United Kingdom who defeated the Italians in 1941, the remark rekindled the nationalistic pride of some members of the British government. Thus, Mr. Brendan Bracken, who was Minister of Information speaking on behalf of Winston Churchill's ruling Conservative Party in Britain, commented, "The authors trying to champion Ethiopia by blackening the name of this country. But I think that the record of British military achievement in Ethiopia and of our subsequent dealings with that country can stand up for themselves. This paper contains attacks on England which are worthy of gobbles. It has insulted the British troops who have rescued Ethiopia, and in my opinion, it is a poisonous rag." Steer, 1942. Notwithstanding the British official position, the defeat of the Italians in Ethiopia was in fact achieved mainly by the Ethiopian patriots. Sylvia Pankhurst, 1960, states, "Throughout the campaign, the patriots fought in the mountains. Generals Platt and Cunningham advanced by the roads from which they scarcely departed. Everywhere these generals received patriot support. A force of 200,000 Italians was destroyed. 40,000 were vanquished by the Emperor's army, 35,000 by the Patriot forces, 85,000 by General Platt with Patriot assistance, 40,000 by General Cunningham and Patriot assistance, 377. In any case, the end of occupation of Ethiopia with the intervention of the British did not mean, as many Patriot leaders, particularly Bele Zelike, had feared, the immediate independence of the country. It rather marked the beginning of a diplomatic tug of war between the Negus and the United Kingdom. For no sooner had the total defeat of the fascist forces in the Horn of Africa been achieved than British military commanders openly exhibited their ulterior motive. They did not come in to help in the liberation of the country and then simply make an exit. They were there to stay. The Haile Selassie I, period 2, 1941-1974. After overcoming some British military personnel's initial ambitions to declare Ethiopia a British protectorate, Haile Selassie I resumed the modernization of his feudal autocracy. He reopened the educational establishments the fascists had closed down and built many new ones throughout the empire. Secondary schools were opened in the major cities of Addis Ababa and Harar. In 1950, the University College of Addis Ababa was opened to accommodate the graduates of the new academic high schools. This became the base around which the Haile Selassie I University, later renamed Addis Ababa University, was established at the palace the emperor donated. The university brought together the colleges of public health, agriculture, engineering, building, and theology. Other faculties and colleagues were later added in the fields of medicine, education, law, social work, Ethiopian studies, and business administration. Teaching hospitals were created to produce nurses and dressers for the hospitals and health centers established throughout the empire. Roads built by the Italians were expanded, a modern Air Force training center was opened, and one of the most successful crown corporations, Ethiopian Airlines, was established. A modern telecommunications center was opened. Economic development was taking place at a respectable rate of 4%, which was higher than for the rest of the African countries combined. Under Haile Selassie's first leadership, Ethiopia became a founding member of the United Nations in 1945, and Eritrea was federated with its mother country in 1952 following a very successful diplomatic move at the United Nations. The world body was persuaded to station its economic commissions for Africa in Addis Ababa. Using his stature as the eldest statesman of Africa, Haile Selassie I also convinced the African leaders to choose Addis Ababa as the capital of the Organization of African Unity, later the African Union, at its founding in 1963. Despite these commendable achievements, Haile Selassie I refused to bring about the political reforms agitated for by the educated Ethiopians his modern school system had produced. Absentee landlords, the church, and the royal family still controlled 90% of the land, and peasants paid up to 75% of their produce to their landlords. The bicameral parliament Haile Selassie first instituted kept the Senate appointive by him, with the Chamber of Deputies being elective. But the emperor still held veto power over the decisions of both. Furthermore, the revised constitution of 1955, far from limiting the power of the emperor, still referred to Haile Selassie's first person as sacred. Haile Selassie I also applied his policy of shum shir, appointed demote, against those who opposed rapid social and political reforms. He made them senators, a position with prestige but no authority, stationed them as ambassadors abroad, far away from domestic affairs, or even dismissed or incarcerated them if they were bold enough to challenge the policies to which he had clearly committed himself. The status of the emperor in the constitution. The constitution of 1931 simply reasserted the emperor's status as recognized by the Ethiopian Orthodox Church and the age-old tradition of the country. It reserved imperial succession to the line of Haile Selassie I and declared in Article 11 that the person of the emperor is sacred, his dignity inviolable, his power indisputable. The revised constitution of 1955 did not revoke this. It simply reiterated it. The governmental structure was tailored to hold institutions characteristics of modern Western style states. A prime minister was appointed by the emperor to manage the governmental process. For all practical purposes, command over central and local government, the legislature, the judiciary, and the military remained with the Negus. As head of state and government, Haile Selassie I held supreme authority to conduct shum shir, to keep control over the new nobility that kept the system going. He could declare war, state of emergency, and martial law at will. Japanization and Ethiopia's new political structure. Japanization, which meant following the Japanese example in introducing westernization to a feudal order, was launched at the urgings of the new political elite. In Japan, power was centralized, but the samurai group that constituted the mercantile class enjoyed a high degree of respect from the populace even before the 1868 Meiji Restoration. Its members held prestige and power but did not hold property in land, because the Meiji land settlement had freed the peasants from servitude to their landlords by compensating the latter with the government's bond. Haile Selassie I, Ethiopia had, by contrast, no such class. The regional and local administrative units remained archaic, and the purpose of the new parliament, which was not elected and could therefore not claim popular representation, was to be a palliative for enlightened despotism and centralization, not a source of delegation of authority, which is a precondition for contemporary liberalism and civic society. The nature of the political system after 1941. Haile Selassie I's modernization efforts were temporarily halted with, with the fascist invasion of 1936, but were resumed as after liberation in 1941. Starting in 1942, the emperor sought to secure control over local government by placing it under a new centralized administration. Following the rise to power of the Ethiopian People's Revolutionary Democratic Front, EPRDF, in 1991, the number of Warada districts reached 600. It is true that Haile Selassie first did attempt to strengthen the national government by recruiting a new generation of educated Ethiopians who were put in key positions in the ministries with clear-cut job descriptions. Haile Selassie first also instituted a new judicial system, but the judges were again directly appointed by him, did not enjoy political immunity during good behavior, and could be removed at will by imperial order.